want to welcome everyone and thank you for joining us this afternoon. We've got a few surprises here. Some of you may be wondering what's going on the left side of the room. So a good friend of mine, Summer Cody, who's an illustrator, is going to do what's called a visual recording. So as our panel, as we're asking questions, she's going to try to conceptualize this visually. So it's kind of an experiment. We'll see how it comes out. And so just we'll see how good of note taker she is there. So thank you for your support here. So I'm Craig Spiezle. I am the managing director of the Agelight Advisory Group. We're a consultancy based in Seattle, Washington. My background has focused a tremendous amount on identity, security, privacy. My prior life was founder of the Online Trust Alliance, which I now am the chairman emeritus of that. And with me is really, really blessed to have a panel of two experts here. Bruce Schneier does not need much of an introduction, I think, but many of you know he really has some great insights on and vision into security, and you'll be hearing some of that today. And Commissioner McSweeny from the FTC, and again, Commissioner has been very involved in IoT, data breach, disclosures, you name it, from the FTC perspective. And I regret to say that she announced this week that she's resigning in 10 days from the FTC. So she's been a great friend of consumers and to business alike. So this is one of her last.
It's kind of amazing you can give a 2-week notice to that kind of job.
Yeah. Do you think that's adequate there, Bruce? Let me talk about that. So with that said, like I said, we're going to go off script very quickly here. So about 6 months ago, Terrell and I were talking about this session, and it was when in the middle of the hurricane season, and we're looking at the damages that were happening in Florida and Texas and how people weren't prepared. And we looked at also the combination of how certain homes seemed to withstand the impact of a hurricane, and others seemed to kind of implode in themselves. And that kind of came into some of the analogy of data breaches and how organizations aren't prepared. But reality is, we know hurricanes are a natural thing, they're gonna happen, and I think you might suggest data breaches are always gonna happen. So the question is, how do we prepare for that? And just like you now have in different areas of the country, you have building codes. So this is kind of leads to my first question. You know, should we not have security building codes that are required for any company? Recognizing there's no perfect security or privacy, but how do we mitigate that? So Bruce, I'll kind of let you kind of share your views on this. And again, he said, don't share any information beforehand so he can respond very and articulate his points of view here. So go ahead.
So I actually think that regulation is coming. People went to my talk yesterday. I talked a lot about the Internet of Things and cyber physical systems and how the Internet is affecting the world in a direct physical manner. And I think that will be an enormous sea change in regulation. So I look less about data and more about things. But we have been blessed or cursed in our industry with basically governments staying out of it and letting us really code the world as we saw fit. And my belief is that's going to change as things become physical. And then the question is, how do we regulate? I mean, separate how from who? So, you know, what do we do to regulate ourselves? And do we have regulations before the fact, ex ante in legal terms, which are things like building codes and certifications and licensing? Do we regulate ex post, which are things like liabilities, where, or do we do things, which I like to think of as in the middle, that are, you know, transparency measures, labeling requirements. And my guess is we're gonna see a lot of them on a broad spectrum. So I look at, you know, I'm not sure I like the metaphor of building codes, but some sort of rule. You know, if you are gonna put a device on the public internet, it has to meet these particular standards. And we can discuss what they are, we can debate them, but something, right? You know, now the device, you put a DVR on the net and it has a default password, and it gets joined to a botnet. That botnet takes down a domain name server, and that drops the 25 most popular websites on the internet. Right? That happened. That's the Dyn botnet. So as these things happen, I think we are going to see ex-ante regulation, minimum standards, probably not prescriptive like rules, like a 55 mile an hour speed limit, but more regulation-based, like you have to drive prudently in inclement weather, in those sorts of things. I think they are inevitable. It'll be interesting to see how they're enforced. You can imagine them enforced by a government, right? By an FTC, by an FCC. You can imagine them being enforced by the insurance industry. I mean, a lot of building codes are not there by law, but you can't get insurance for your building if you don't meet them, right? So there'll be an entire industry, sort of industry-led regulation. Again, I think we're going to see a mix of both. But I think these are really important discussions to have. They're hard for us to have. We are used to the internet, we're used to the government having no say in what we do. And that was great as long as we were just sending emails and going on Usenet talking about Star Trek. Right? As long as it didn't matter, it didn't matter. But it soon will matter. It'll be about cars and medical devices. It's already about voting machines and thermostats and toys and things that can actually harm us. And, I mean, I watched the Zuckerberg hearings, I don't know if you did, and the one thing I learned was that members of Congress have no idea how the internet works and are going to be terrible at coming up with effective, smart regulations, which I believe means we have to do it. So I'm going to stop there, and we'll talk.
Well, unfortunately, the FTC is also going to be losing a lot of horsepower and knowledge of technology in 10 days. But in the meantime, you know, your view, you know, Terrell, from, you know, the FCC. So, you know, what role does the FTC have? I mean, right now we have 50 different states have regulations, and they range from all across the gamut of not even sure what they do. So in the absence of that, how does a company really know what those rules of the road are? You know, where to drive? How to drive?
So I agree with a lot of what Bruce just said, and since he introduced the concept of ex post versus ex ante regulation.
We're going to teach you Latin here.
I'll
that's
follow
what we do.
Up on that. It's fancy, fancy Latin terminology for essentially what we have right now, which is the Federal Trade Commission, which is my agency, can basically bring an enforcement case if it decides that consumers have been deceived or treated unfairly. And a lot of our data security cases, and there are a little bit more than 60 of them, involve a sort of unreasonable security practice, which we decide if it's really unreasonable is unfair to consumers. So that's kind of how it works right now. Again, it's very much a after the fact, ex post kind of formulation. So the question becomes, well, how do you know what's reasonable so that you avoid getting prosecuted by an agency like the Federal Trade Commission? And what the FTC has done over time is put out a ton of guidance. Now, guidance isn't a rule or a regulation, but it does say, here's what we think the best practices are, and here's what we think, if you're doing them, you're probably doing reasonable security, which probably means we're not going to prosecute you if you have a breach or an incident. We have an initiative, this is all available on our website, called Start with Security. We followed up with Stick with Security. See where we're going with this. We put out regular blog posts also explaining both kinds of issues we're seeing in cases we're not bringing, but are issues nonetheless, as well as describing issues that we are seeing and cases that we are bringing. Really briefly, I also want to take on the notion for a second that we don't have security regulation already in place. I think there should be more, and I think it would be nice to have clear data security requirements and a little more authority for the Federal Trade Commission in this area. But in fact, there are already some pretty clear rules in certain industries. The safeguards rule, for example, which is in GLB. In HIPAA, there's rules. In COPPA, which is the Child Online Privacy Protection Act, there's also requirements and rules. These are basically, again, a kind of reasonableness standard. It's there, it's more or less designing with security in mind, building with security, knowing what's on your network, having reasonable procedures, having vulnerability disclosure programs, responding to reports of vulnerability, you know, knowing, you know, some of the basic stuff. Again, I think of reasonableness as like, if you talk to a security expert and they say, that sounds reasonable, then you're probably fine. If you talk to a security expert and they go, oh my God, like, probably a problem. If it's like a little like, maybe take a look at it. So we're constantly trying to update those guidances because it is a very dynamic environment, which is one of the reasons why, like, ex ante, before the fact regulations can be challenging in this space. Now, you just alluded to 50 states. That's true. Those are breach notification laws, right? I think I happen to believe it'd be very nice if we could just reconcile that into one breach notification law for at the federal level. But that's something that we'll have to get Congress to do.
Yeah. So Bruce, you know, we were on a panel last year, you testified at a hearing that I was at, and you said, you know what, the market forces are failing. We need a new regulatory regime, a new regulatory agency. Now we were talking about IoT, but it was really about the missteps and industry not adapting and kind of rushing products to market. Where do you feel now on that issue?
I think it's the same. I think this is what we've learned, that this is the level of cybersecurity the market provides. This is it, right? This is optimal given the current regulatory environment. Right? If anything the market economy is good at is optimizing for conditions. So this is what we have. If we like this, we're good. If we decide we don't like this, then we need to change the incentive structure. And that's regulation. Now, I don't think of regulation as bad. I just think of it as designing a playing field to allow competition to work on. And the playing field we have now, which is a product of regulation and non-regulation and laws of physics and, you know, all laws of psychology, all sorts of things, give us this. And we have any number of knobs we can turn to tweak that playing field. And I think what we're learning is that the externalities are just enormous. You know, I teach Internet security policy at the Harvard Kennedy School. It's kind of fun. And one of the things I do is bring in one of those interconnected dolls to have my policy students hack, because it is truly that easy. And it's a lightning moment for them when they realize they don't have to be a tech whiz to hack some of these things. You could just be a regular person with an iPhone.
So, I mean, that gets a part of the challenge. And I'll take it back to the FTC. So, okay. I don't design security into my device. It gets hacked. As long as I send out the notices, you know, what's the harm? There's no harm. We've had this argument before, you know. Big deal. My Social Security is out there. So I do the notices, I comply, and I move on. Is that enough?
Yeah, so one of the weaknesses of our current framework, arguably, is that for the FTC to bring a case to decide a practice is unreasonable, it has to decide that it's not reasonably avoidable by a consumer. Now, that's pretty easy, because most consumers really can't understand what exactly your data security practice is unless they come to your company and are like PricewaterhouseCoopers and like doesn't do an audit or something, right? So that's easy. But there has to be a likelihood of harm. So likelihood of harm could be the injury of being rendered identity insecure, could be there's some privacy harms, like a turning a camera on in your bedroom. But one of the areas that the law is kind of struggles with a little bit is how clearly do we have to tie the breach of the data to a harm that someone might experience from identity theft? Because as you know, there might be multiple sources of that information out there, and it's hard to know and do the forensics of that. So it's an area that the law struggles with, and that if we could clarify it through some kind of regulation, it might be very helpful. A word for a second just on the incentive thing, because I totally agree with that point. If we want to get all economic for a minute, there's a huge information asymmetry. We're depending on the demand side of the market in IoT, which is consumers, to make assessments about the adequacy of data security practices for stuff they're connected, stuff they're buying. And that's as crazy as depending on them to also be the primary cybersecurity people for those devices, okay? Like, they have no ability to interact meaningfully with, to create an incentive for better data security practice unless the company just decides to invest in it to begin with. And very often that investment choice is kind of very challenging because you're trying to bring a competitively priced product to market. So this is a big challenge. That's why regulation might be justified in this area. You wouldn't want it to be, you'd want it to be tech neutral and not overly burdensome, but you would want to be able to say, look, okay, this is the minimum standard that we all have to hit, because the incentives aren't working that way.
And I think harm is interesting. So, and we have a lot of trouble in this industry with that. You were probably a victim of the Equifax breach, and you go to court, and you'll be asked, what's the harm? You need to point to an actual harm. And you can say that, you know, my data was used to make this credit, open this credit card, and there was fraud. Well, how can you prove that was attached to this data breach and not one of the 30 other data breaches? And there have been several FTC cases where they lost because you couldn't prove that direct harm. Now, we know how to deal with this, and it's called statutory damages. If you copy a Disney movie, Disney does not have to prove harm. There are statutory damages they can collect from you, regardless of any harm. If you are illegally wiretapped by the government, you do not have to prove harm. In both these cases, the law prescribes statutory damages. Now, this is another act of Congress to fix this, but I think that's a very important one, because in this world where it's hard to connect the bad thing that happened to your data with the actual harm, statutory damages are how we enforce some kind of accountability.
So Bruce, I'm going to challenge that for a second.
Sure.
I think the harms are moving from, my Social Security number was linked or disclosed, to what I'm using another, the term hazardization, the actual physical and life safety issues that are now occurring or can occur from this device when it's compromised. So it's not just my data, but it disables my smoke alarms in my home, and now I have a fire. It opens up my doors and my house is broken into. My thermostat shut off, my pipes freeze. There's lots of different scenarios that aren't really that hard to really, get to at this point here. So I think we may be at the point of, now you're talking about real liabilities, real physical harms. And, you've kind of touched on that before, and I tell you, it's encouraging now because the Consumer Product Safety Commission is now engaged in this conversation.
I agree. I mean, this is actually the topic of the book I just finished. I mean, this notion of when the internet becomes physical. And yes, of course, it's a lot easier to point to harms. Although, the question I ask, if we saw this case with Amity, they provided locks for hotel rooms, lousy software, a bad vulnerability. It was hacked. All these locks are insecure. Hotels sued. And Amity basically went to court and said, show me hotel rooms that were actually broken into. Not theoretical they could be, but actual broken into and stuff stolen. And if you can't, there's no harm. So here, even in a physical realm, there was this problem. I mean, yes, if pipes freeze, if your car crashes, that's easy. And that's the extreme case. I'd like to back it a couple of degrees.
Any comment on that, or
yeah, maybe on this harm question, there's an added problem. There's the forensics of trying to attach a harm of identity theft, for example, to a specific breach, because that is challenging. That also takes a tremendous amount of resources. So if what we think is a public good here is better data security on the Internet of Things, for example, the FTC is trying to do that. You as taxpayers pay about $300 million a year for the FTC, which, by the way, at the federal level is very small for an agency. It would take a huge amount of resources for us to do the forensics to attach ID theft to specific breach for 250 million people. So it's not an efficient use of resources either.
Yeah. Well, actually, on Monday, I participated in the e-fraud forum, which is primarily law enforcement and the banking industry. And the belief is all that data is out there now, so that you probably won't be able to correlate that, between the Equifaxes and the others. And so one of the whole concepts is driving the value of that information to zero.
Yeah, the
that's
problem
a concept.
Is, so I, yeah, I, the, all the information is out there, so why do we even care argument is I get most frustrated with
that. Not that why you shouldn't care, but how do we just drive that to zero, the value? So it's we don't use Social Security numbers anymore. If we don't use these other identifiers.
It's easy to drive arbitrary information to zero, the value zero, but the value of your bank account, the value of your medical data, I mean, that's gonna be personal privacy, and you'll never drive that to zero. Mm-hmm. Right? I mean, yes, the Social Security number, obviously, you just make it useless, and there's no value in it. You make accounts one time, there's no value in it. But it's the personal piece of information you'll never be able to drive zero.
Well, this probably
we're getting into a really specific breach of information conversation. What we are talking about, which I think is more important, is the fact that the Internet of Things really changes it. And I love Bruce's point here in his book, which I think you should be promoting and we'll read when it comes out, which is that the Internet is starting to affect the physical world, right? And that is a big change. Insecure, we wrote a report at the FTC in 2015 where we predicted that IoT would be used in DDoS attacks. That has definitely happened. We also have been studying the problem of ransomware, which we know is a problem at the business level, right? We know hospitals are suffering, the whole entire city of Atlanta. We know ransomware is a problem at enterprise. I think it's going to start being a nuisance problem for consumers and their IoT. This is going to be really problematic too. So there's a bunch of, and I mean, then there's all the safety stuff that you just raised about locks and fire detectors and smoke alarms and all those kinds of safety issues that come up that are security issues.
Well, you know, you mentioned we've been talking about the U.S. regime, and I might suggest that we're kind of looking at the wrong legal framework. We should be thinking about the GDPR because any of these companies probably have a customer or an employee in Europe and such. And so, you know, I guess one of the challenges I might suggest is are we slipping behind the rest of the world in privacy rights and controls and breach notifications? And should we, so I'd like your thoughts on that, and should we just be saying, hey, GDPR becomes the standard to drive towards?
So I think this is going to be interesting to watch. I mean, the previous slide talked about all 50 states having breach notification laws and them being different. I mean, so that's that same dynamic plays out around the world. You know, all countries have different laws. And it's interesting to watch how the laws will bleed over. Right, so right now, the car you buy in the US is not the car you buy in Mexico because the environmental control laws are different. On the other hand, the car you buy in California is the same car you buy in Nevada, even though the environmental controls are different. So how does this translate into data? Right? So at the low level, at the consumer level, my guess is the toy you buy in Europe will be the toy you buy in the US. Much cheaper to build it once. If you got to make it secure, you're going to make it secure everywhere because it's just easier. But is the Facebook you get in Europe going to be the Facebook you get in the United States? Now, Mark Zuckerberg did say that he will apply GDPR controls everywhere. I'm pretty sure he didn't know what he was talking about. I just can't imagine doing that because that completely blows his business model. But if he does, that'll be real interesting. If he doesn't, GDPR applies to European residents and European citizens wherever they lie. So he's going to have to figure that out. Now, you mentioned that it would be great if we could harmonize things. I think it would be great. But it's not going to happen globally anytime soon. I mean, maybe it'll happen in the US, but these are all global issues. So, I mean, yes, I think we're falling behind. I think Europe is the regulatory superpower on the planet right now. And they are not afraid to impose fines that make companies take notice instead of fines that make companies say, yeah, I guess that's cheaper than the lawyers, we'll pay it. So the next few months will be very interesting to watch. This is all in how it's going to be enforced. I think it comes into effect in 6 weeks, it comes into force. One of the people in charge of enforcement was asked a couple of weeks ago, will there be a grace period? And she said, yes, the law comes into force on Saturday, and we won't get into work till Monday. So I think they are going to be looking for some scalps. They're going to be looking for the most egregious violators, and really like the FTC does, trying to drive best practices through example. Right? It remains to be seen. Now, what do you think of this? It's kind of, you know, it's almost like what you would do if you could.
It's pretty similar to what I personally would do if I could, with some pretty big caveats. For example, so we're talking about, for those of you, does everybody know what GDPR is? Yes, yes, everybody's good. All right, this is a big regulation of data privacy that's happening in Europe. But what's really different about what they're doing than what we have here is they have a rights-based framework. So here, you don't have a right to delete your data. You don't have a right to really pull it out of things once you consent to it. Mostly you have to read a really long privacy policy and click I agree, and once you do, good luck. Like, that's it. Very often, there's very little the FTC can do if you don't like what happens from that point forward. We look at whether you really had truthful information and you really had opt-ins, clear choices at the time sensitive information was collected so that you understood how it was going to be used. But if you did, then like that's basically it. That's the paradigm. And the shift in Europe is really into this rights framework where individual citizens in Europe will have control over their data. I think we do need to right-size our rights to our data. I wouldn't do it exactly the same way as the GDPR. But I think if we do give individual consumers more control over their data, we're going to reach into the plumbing of how the data is being used in the companies. And in the same way that we think about it from a security perspective, which is companies are really going to have to know whose data they have. They're going to have to know how long they're holding it. They're going to have to be accountable for it. And that's already a requirement in the European regulation. And I think it would be nice to have that requirement here because I think it would go a long way towards changing the incentive structure, which right now is basically collect everything, hold everything, see what you can use it for, maybe sell it later, which is not so much has that doesn't have that much to do with security, except that it's not an awesome security practice because it creates huge exposure.
But here we have something different. So I've heard this called the biggest lie on the internet, and you all committed it. So when you got to this conference, you checked a box that says, I acknowledge that I have read the wireless policy, right? To get on the wireless at this conference, you all check that box. None of you read the wireless policy. In that wireless policy are all the things you agree to. And we could start reading it, but my guess is there's not enough time left in this panel.
Right.
Yeah, all right, so, okay. My agency's totally responsible for the fact that everybody has these really long privacy policy in terms of service agreements that nobody reads, that everybody clicks I agree on. We're responsible for that because about 25 years ago, when people were thinking about this worldwide web thing and whether consumers would trust it, we said, well, one thing nobody's talking about is what is your privacy policy, so you should have one of those. And we're pretty good at getting everybody to have one of those, right? They do exist. We've been trying to get better at having those be transformed into meaningful options for consumers that they read and can interact with. That's a harder struggle. But those policies are useful for certain things. So I'm a little bit leery about totally criticizing them, your points, right? Because the FTC does read them. And if you aren't doing, if your tech doesn't work the way it is purported to work in that policy, that can be problematic.
And you've actually sued people because they didn't follow their own policy that they could change arbitrarily without telling their users even.
That's right. And then those policies also do serve as a sort of governing document for an organization. So I think they're useful in that way. But they're not meaningful, I agree, for consumers.
They're not meaningful, they're not comparable. And I'd have to say I participated in some of those multi-stakeholder efforts that were stood up by NTIA, and we failed. We could not come up with that nutrition label. And part of it that some people didn't want to be that open about what there was. So the more vague and nondescript, so there's that.
Yeah,
you know.
And it gets even harder. Right now we're at least talking about screens people are interfacing with, but as we move into IoT screenless land, I think these consents are going to be really challenging. Now they're required if you're dealing with European citizen data, by the way, no matter where it is in the world. So just to FYI, if this is the first you're hearing of this, like probably go chat with somebody. So it's going to be really, really hard, the consent framework in the screenless environment.
By the way, I do need to put clarification. Her views are her own.
Yeah, they're totally my own.
Oh, yeah, well, this is total official U.S. government position. Trump will tweet it tomorrow. So I think you make a really excellent point when you say that you read them. Right. These disclosures.
Well, I don't. I'm a regular consumer.
Your organization. The disclosures are not meant to give consumers information, but to give consumer advocacy groups information. Because right? my parents are not going to read them, no matter how clear they are. But there will be a Consumer Reports. There will be an FTC. There will be somebody that will read a newspaper that will read them, digest them, and then tell consumers, you know, we read all of these security privacy policies, you don't have to, and we recommend these three baby monitors, don't buy those seven. Mm-hmm. Right? And that's the mechanism because it's so tech. I don't need these to be understandable by consumers like nutritional labels. I need them to be in a standard form that some advocacy group can read, digest, analyze, and then explain. Yeah.
And in fairness, those efforts are happening. So Consumer Reports is starting to try to do some scoring of different IoT products in their security. This is very challenging because we don't really have like a heavy standards framework, so they have to come up with how do you even score in the first place to give a score to different products. But they've done it for televisions. Underwriter Laboratories is working on this as well. So I think there are some really good efforts out there around trying to create some kind of scoring labeling system that could be meaningful for regular consumers when they go to buy their connected stuff. Yeah, but it's hard.
Yeah, and just to give a plug for my old job, the Online Trust Alliance, we actually did an honor roll trust audit and going through those privacy policies and you know, to read them literally line by line and score them. And it's a very tough process. And a lot of them are circular conversations and they point to other documents and then you're at that other document. So it's really hard.
Did you score them on how they would put you to sleep, how well they'd be?
Yeah. And how much hair I lost so on there. I want to touch on this one real quick only because, you know, Terrell, you've mentioned reasonable. And one of the arguments from industry says, well, I need things more prescriptive. You're saying reasonable, I don't know. Is that reasonable, it's only five dev hours to do it? Or is it 1,000 hours to do that? So that's not necessarily a criticism, but it is certainly a comment that I hear over and over.
It is feedback I hear over and over too, Craig. So one of the big beefs, all right, so Bruce introduced this concept of ex post enforcement. So we're back in that box again, which is if you're an enforcement agency and your mandate is to protect consumers from unfair, deceptive acts and practices, and you're doing that in data security, your standard becomes, is that unreasonable? Okay, well, what does that mean? Which is why we put out tons and tons of guidance documents I was talking about. They're all on our website and blog posts, all of them written for non-lawyers, okay? They go through like specific facts and what went wrong and why that wasn't reasonable. They're very useful. The thing that's maybe flexible and good about this framework is that it also depends a little bit on the amount of data you're talking about, the level of sensitivity, the size of the company, and their level of sophistication as to what we think they ought to be doing. So it is a little bit of a gradation. I think query whether you want that kind of flexibility built in a very dynamic system, I go with yes. But it's not quite as, I guess, bright line as a very heavy-handed prescriptive regulatory system. I like your description of Europe as a regulatory superpower. I think that's fair. That's not really our approach here.
So, you know, this is going to tie back to where we kind of started from here. And, you know, you just had a settlement with Uber, you know, and I have this theory that are we at this mode of cybersecurity like...
But I guess if Uber would do it, it's not reasonable. We have a good standard there, right? I guess you're not allowed to say that.
I'm going off the FTC in like 10 days, but I still wouldn't say that.
But you know, before Enron, and we know what, again, the accounting practices, and again, and a lot of this is, you know, I talk about stewardship, it's ethics, it's doing the right things. And is it, you know, companies are just trying to, you know, they're moving forward, or are they not taking the time to really think about responsible ethical practices that creates this tension?
Well, all right, so one answer to this question might be that, and someone's already raised it, at the FTC, we did just conclude our Uber case. We were investigating them. We had reached a consent decree. They told us, they didn't tell us about this major 2016 breach. We're like, okay, we're gonna redo this consent decree. And we included for the first time an incident reporting requirement to us, which is a new thing for the FTC to do. But what's not in there is any kind of fine, because we don't have, in the first instance, penalty authority. Right. We only get to that if we already have a company under order and then they violate that order, which is what this whole Facebook debate is about. So it's different than the European approach, which is these very significant fines if you violate the very clear regulations. You know, that's a bigger stick. It creates a bigger incentive. So one thing that might be happening here is the as a company assesses the risk of violating the law and running afoul of the FTC and realizes the consequences in order of saying you should do a better job and have a data security program and don't lie to people about this and maybe have an assessment and now they have an incident reporting requirement. The trouble will start if they violate that, right? This is, again, what we're seeing play out in this question about the Facebook situation. But it isn't necessarily very costly, at least at the beginning.
And I think we're better off with more flexible guidelines and standards rather than 55 mile an hour speed limit rule. I mean, actual, you know, this is the password rule, this is the update rule. Because we know this. This environment changes.
Yeah.
It changes because of tech. It changes because of just computers getting faster. It changes because attackers adapt. And what was reasonable 5 years ago is not reasonable today. And we all know this. Right? As engineers, we get this. So now we have to somehow code that into the authorities and the regulations. And this is doable. I think we do this in a lot of it. We do this in environmental law. We do this in banking. This is not new. This is not weird. This is not abnormal. So when companies say, we don't know what's reasonable, you need to tell us, they're just complaining because they complain. I don't think they have a legitimate complaint.
And also just to say, there are already data security rules, right? So you've got Equifax up there. I'm not commenting on our investigation of that. But that was a pretty significant breach. There was a lot of discussion of like, well, if there was a regulation, then it would have been clear or something right when that happened. And they're covered by the safeguards rule. So they're under a regulation, and that happened. So it happens.
You talk about Equifax and Panera Bread, at least from what I read. In this case, is obviously, I agree with you, Bruce. There's no perfect security. You know, we don't want to have regulations that are so prescriptive that become outdated by the time the ink dries. But, you know, Equifax, there's case after case after case where, you know, researchers contacted companies and say, we found this vulnerability. And in some cases, they're dismissed. Some cases, the companies think, yeah, it's not a priority. And again, they were warned. And so at that point, you know, does that shift the conversation, you know, to one of neglect? You know, they've made a decision to not adhere to those warnings.
Right. And Yahoo also was accused of that. And one more thing about, so I think you can see how it's done bad. This is also from Europe. You know, when you go to Europe, all the websites say, we use cookies. And you have to click OK. That's an example of a regulation that was outdated as soon as it came into force. Mm-hmm. And back then, cookies were how you attract, and giving people a warning made sense. Very quickly, you attract by many other technologies, so the cookies are largely irrelevant now. And the warning is something people swat through to get to the site they want to go to anyway. So they're ineffective in several dimensions because that was a very proscriptive, you must alert people when you use cookies regulation and not a more general, you know, you need to inform people how you are collecting their data, which is what we're getting in GDPR. So we'll see how that adapts.
So can I just pose this slightly different way? In a clear regulation, if the regulation is, if a vulnerability is disclosed to you, then you must take action, right? Well, if you've ever looked at vulnerability reports, right, or anything, you'd be like, oh, there's like 10,000 here. Are they exploitable? What's going on, right? I don't know that that's exactly the right prescription. What you want is someone to go, okay, how serious is this? How widely known is it? What's at stake, right? You need people to go through a series of steps in analyzing whether they need to mitigate the vulnerability.
Great. We only have about 5 minutes left.
Really?
Take a few questions, and then I want to make sure Bruce and Commissioner McSweeny have a chance to wrap up. But can a short question be great?
Sure. The thing that attracted me was the idea of IoT and building codes. And I'm going to respectfully disagree with Bruce. I think building codes is a great metaphor.
Thank you. You were saying
we don't want to be prescriptive about 55 mile an hour speed limits. And here's the way I think building code metaphor comes in. Okay, 55 mile an hour speed limit is an operational thing. That's the user of the technology, right? However, there is, I believe, some kind of a regulation or there would be a lawsuit if the car I was driving was incapable of doing 55 miles an hour safely on a highway that was rated for 55. And I think that's where we have the problem now. Mm-hmm. We have devices that users are using in a, and Terrell, you hit on this, they're using in a way that appears to have been the intended use, but they're not safe for using in that fashion. So I think that's where building code metaphor fits, is here's the things you have to do at a minimum in order for the device to operate in a way that's intended.
And that seems to clearly get into unfair and deceptive, right? If I'm sold a device that I cannot operate safely, one would hope you have a cause for action.
Yeah,
but I don't think you can use the reasonable, I think Terrell kind of hit on that a little bit, you can't use the reasonable measure without having a description of it.
Right. I think that's right. And I actually happen to like building codes. I think that makes sense. Sometimes we talk about, I love tech metaphors, right? Because it's like, how do I explain this complicated thing? So in the Uber case, for example, when we just posted a blog on this, it's actually a pretty good read. The issue is really what do you do to secure non-production software environments? And there it was like, okay, well, we got to have some flexibility in those environments, but we got to make sure that they're not totally exploitable. And so the metaphor we came up with there was like, okay, make sure that construction site is fenced off properly so that people don't fall into it. Even if there's no, like, because you can't say, like, have all doors be locked if there are no walls. Like, that doesn't make any sense. but so you have to come up with a metaphor that makes sense. But I do think we need some of those, like, all right, is that fenced off properly? And we want to make sure people are not able to get into that site and hurt themselves.
We have time for, if there's not another question, we have a question there, and then we'll do a kind of wrap up.
You got to ask a very quick question.
Yeah, sorry.
Yes or no question.
Oh.
I'll pay you, by the way.
It's not deceptive, though.
I'll try to make it quick, though. So I'm curious about your focus on the risks related to IoT. And to me, it seems that there's a lot of similarity between IoT risk and control system risk. So this idea of physical impact as a distinction is something we've dealt with for a long time. And that risk hasn't really led to regulations like you've been talking about. Why do you think that now we're in this environment of pending regulation about cybersecurity whenever we haven't really seen this in a lot of industrial areas where you have widespread risk and impact?
I mean, my short answer on this is I think the physical world impacts here is real, but there's a big supply chain problem. I think we're all aware of it. There's a huge incentive to ship insecure, crappy stuff that people will buy at a cheap price point, and they will have no idea if it's secure or not. And there's a collective problem because it's not just my dumb, insecure toaster that is compromising my home network and everything on it. It's my dumb, insecure toaster compromising my home network and then DDoSing the electrical grid or something like that, right? So we have a huge collective interest in trying to make sure this stuff is built better and more securely. It's really hard to achieve that given the incentives in the marketplace right now.
So in part, NIST cybersecurity...
I'm sorry.
Yeah.
Go ahead, Rich. Sum up?
Yeah.
So I'm going to end where I started. I think panels like this are vital. That regulation is coming, and talking about how it could work, how it could fail from an engineering systemic perspective is something we can do and lawmakers really can't. And very much we need to get involved in these debates. So I'm happy you're here, and I want you to go back and keep thinking about this and write your legislatures and get involved, because these things are going to happen to us if we don't do this first.
Yeah, I love that. I think become a design with security and privacy and ethics evangelist. That is fantastic. Craig, can you finish by answering why there are cows on this slide?
Yeah, so these are the photos, by the way, if you like them, I love that. They're all photos I took while I was riding my bicycle. So this is the concept of the tragedy of the commons. If we don't work together,
you ride your bicycle in nice places.
Yeah.
So this was, I rode cross country, so this was, you know, the best I could come up with, you know, in there. So, and you know, the photo of the bike riding, that was me at the back of the pack looking forward in I can't remember.
The Tour de France.
Yeah, there you go. But you know, I do want to point out just a few things that today is a deadline. NIST has input on a document regarding IoT. They have the
Consumer Product Safety Commission.
Yeah, they have a
the hazard people.
They have a call for comments that's due on May 2nd. And one of the big things that I've been working with them is this area of hazardization. So getting back to Bruce, your point, you have some input. This is an opportunity. So it's really about the physical hazards. The UK, they have a call for input on their IoT safety regulations on April 25th. So there's lots of opportunities here. So I'm happy to kind of connect offline here. But I do want to thank Bruce, your time, and Terrell. I mean, again, we need to have these debates and hopefully move the ball in the right direction. A year from now, we're hopefully talking about other things.
And I think we should thank our artists. This is amazing. Yes. Please come check this out. Take a picture.
So we have a chance. So we'll,
thank you all.
We'll take a photo of this. And good job to Summer on there. She's kind of cleaning things up there. But we'll see what that work is there. But again, thank you to the panel here for your great time.
Thank you very much.